Clarity on Fire, a podcast for people who know what they don't want out of their life and career, but aren't sure what they'd rather be doing.
In a world where it's easy to exist, but hard to feel alive, we, Kristen
and Rachel,
two certified life and career coaches, are here to help you cut through the information overload, get unstuck, and focus not just on how you can have a career you're passionate about, but how to create a whole life that feels fulfilling.
So join us here, where we serve up inspiration and down-to-earth wisdom in a way that only two best friends can.
We want you to experience the relief of knowing that, yes, you're allowed to want more out of your life and career.
And no, you don't have to wander through the dark anymore. Our job is to light the fire that shows you the way. Let's go. Hey, do you remember this?
Call me, beat me, if you want to reach me, if you want to page me, that's okay.
Remember
that's
that?
A very select group of people who are going to know exactly what you are talking about.
But I want people to call, beep, and page and try to reach us.
Well, actually,
they can't do any of that, but they can text us.
Well, we can text them.
Okay, well, it doesn't sound as cool.
Well, you know, they can text us to opt into texting, which is kind of meta.
But then they can't keep texting us after that because we won't respond.
I mean, this isn't a waste of your time.
I don't even know if we get it. It might just go into an ether
somewhere. I have no idea what happens.
But if you want to text us, like get something off your chest, even though we'll never see it, like do that.
That could be cathartic.
I think that'd be kind of cool. But just don't count on the fact that we're not seeing it.
I mean, there's probably a way. I just haven't figured it out yet.
I mean, like, don't commit anything to text that you don't want to be seen in a court of law. Because I might have to turn it over if you've, you know, getting it off your chest that you killed someone. I think I'd have to tell on you, even though you're one of our fans and it would bring me pain to do that. So, yeah, do you want to text us? Because we now have the capacity to text you. So,
well, if you
got
you
two
get,
options.
Okay, if you want to get our texts, first of all, you can text us first at...
That's what I'm saying. They have to text us in order to sign up.
Well, that's one of the ways. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So you can text us at 703-783-3223.
703-783-3223.
Yeah. Rachel was practicing that before we hit record.
I did that by memory. Kristen did it. Now, if you text us, you have to do it correctly. So you have to do your first name. Please capitalize it. I don't want to have you in my system as Rachel with a little R, okay? That just drives me up a wall. So capital first name, space, just one space, your email address.
That's it.
That's it. But that's the right format.
If you don't do it in the right format, you might not get opted in. I can't guarantee that you will. So
yeah,
just
if you don't get like a confirmation like, hello, welcome, you might have done it wrong.
Yeah.
In which case, you can go also to the show notes and click the link where we have a little opt-in box on our site that you can enter your name, email, and phone number, and then we will have you on our texting list.
Yep.
So I'm going to text you guys on Monday for the first time.
Yeah.
And I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm going to pick something good to motivate you on a Monday.
And they're going to be about twice a week is what we're planning on.
Yeah. No, I mean, listen, I'm not that desperate.
You're not getting a daily text from us.
No. I don't operate like that. This has got to be like a two-way street in terms of energy.
Well, you're looking forward to your next text.
I don't need them being like, whoa, do less. Like stage five clinger alert, you know? Like, no.
Also, I think I said this in the last one, but save us as Clarity on Fire in your phone, because then otherwise you're going to be like, who is this weird random number texting me?
Yeah.
And you're going to not read our text.
Or save us as Crachel.
Yeah,
save us as whatever you want, but like know that it's us.
Yes.
And then we challenge you to find a great image of us
to make your contact
that represents us.
And then please share it with us.
Tell us what you picked. I have ideas that I shared in the last episode, so go back.
You can leave a comment on this episode. We always leave a link. But you can also just email us at
let us know what you
contact@clarityonfire.com just to bring us a little joy.
So before we get into the episode this week, which is about the Enneagram, I wanted to update you about an episode we did 2 or 3 weeks ago, our book club, our January book club about E squared. We got a couple of really great stories after you guys heard that episode, and I have to go back and share these with you.
If you have not listened, please go back and listen. It was a really, really fun one, and people have had a lot of interesting results from it. Yeah. Essentially, it's you playing with like universal forces to say, hey, are you out there? Are you supporting me? Show me a sign. Mm-hmm. And we have some really cool signs that people shared with us. So
Okay.
Go ahead and read the first one.
Madison says, man, you ladies have been posting some timely content lately. I picked up this book, E Squared, a few days ago, and last Thursday read the chapter on experiment number one, asking the field of potentiality, aka the universe, for an unmistakable sign of its existence. That evening, as I was scanning through my new podcast episodes, this one about E Squared came up, and I was floored. Pretty cool, huh? That's a very meta sign. She picks up the book and then she was like, all right, give me a sign. And then she realizes that we have just published an episode about this book.
The book was the sign.
I love it.
That's so cool. Then we had another one, which just absolutely amazed me. Hi, ladies. I just had to share this story with you after hearing your podcast the other day. I gave one of the experiments from the E Squared book a go, and oh my God, it works. I was debating on a career change to working with animals. I told the universe that I wanted a border collie dog, my favorite dog that I don't see around here very often, to come up to me out of the blue. I said that would be my sign that this is the right career move. 14 hours later, a border collie ran into the road I was driving on. I stopped and got out, and he ran right up to me and gave me a big hug. I phoned the number on the tag, but it was disconnected. I then spent the next 5 hours with the dog as I tried to find the owner. Eventually, he was reunited, but I had to laugh because my request was for an interaction with that dog. And in less than 24 hours, I got to interact with the exact dog I requested for several hours. Just incredible. I can't wait to read the book to see what else can happen. Thanks. And that's from Kirsty.
Kirsty didn't even read the book. She just heard the episode and said, I'll give that a try. And then the universe came and smacked her upside the head with itself. I love that.
And the dog came up and gave her a hug.
And
oh,
like,
my God.
She saved that dog's life, yes. Most likely. I mean, just, like, talk about, like, knocking it out of the park on your first batting, Kirsty. Like, my kudos to you. But, like, if Kirsty can do it and she didn't read the book, then, like, why can't you guys do it? You can't. So please go back and listen to that episode from a few weeks ago. It was January 31st. I think it was the last day in January. All right, let's just transition right quick to what this episode is actually about, which is more Enneagram stuff.
Can you tell we're obsessed?
Yeah. So I'll link to the episodes we did 6 months ago on...
The two-parter.
Two-part Wisdom of the Enneagram bonus book club series. Go back if you don't want to... You don't have to listen to those before you listen to this, by the way. But if you want to listen to those, scroll back to August 2019, the end of the month. We had 2 hour long, each one was an hour, dive into the wisdom of the Enneagram.
And the Enneagram, the more you dig, it's a deep, deep just assessment tool. There's just a lot of stuff to swim in. So we barely scratched the surface in 2 hours.
There's no limit to what you can learn about the Enneagram. And also the reason I wanted, okay, so this came up. The soul child theory thing I just recently discovered because our friend Joanna was like raving about this Instagram series that this woman had done. And then we started reading them aloud at our
last
lunch
get together.
Yeah. And like Joanna was crying and then our friend Stacy started kind of crying. And I was like, well, there's clearly something to this. And I just find it really fascinating. And so I basically what I did was I went and I delved deep into this woman, Sarah Jane Case. She has an Instagram account and podcast, both called Enneagram and Coffee. And I will link to that in the episode description. But you guys should totally go check out her content because she's Enneagram expert. And this is where I first heard about this theory, even though it's not her theory. It's something she's just sharing. But I didn't know about it before this. I wanted to touch on someone. I wanted to give you someone to go follow who's more of an Enneagram expert than me and Kristen, because sometimes we get questions and I'm like, I don't know how to answer this. I am but an Enneagram novice.
Oh, yeah. We're obsessed and we're interested and love it and have done our own digging.
But I don't really know.
I would not call myself an expert in the Enneagram.
No, not even.
So if you have more in-depth questions, Someone like Sarah Jane probably is going to be much better suited to answer
them. She actually has a whole, I heard this on her podcast this morning when I was listening to it. She has an Enneagram club, which is like a monthly membership. So you can dive deep with her. So I would go check out her content. So basically what I did was I went to Sarah's Sarah Jane's Instagram, and I like went and I kind of took what she was saying about all of the types, and I want to read them to you. I want to share with you guys what she's saying about this because it's kind of mind-blowing. And then I'm going to link to all of those posts too so you can go reread them and check out your own type.
Yeah, we're recreating our last girls' lunch where we did
basically
this, everyone started crying, and maybe you will
too. Yeah. Okay, so before we get into all of the types, I just want to like cover a few points. Like, what is Enneagram soul child theory? It sounds either really weird and technical or really woo-woo, or maybe some combination of both.
Yeah. So it was originally conceived by a woman named Sandra Maitrey. I don't know how to pronounce her last name.
Right.
I don't want to butcher that, but she's written multiple books about the Enneagram. So she is absolutely an Enneagram expert. And so this is her original theory that then Sarah Jane is just
sharing with us.
Yeah, sharing.
And now we're sharing with you. So we're in like three layers deep now.
Okay. But that's how these things get spread.
So the concept is that as children, we were the number that we as adults go to in times of rest or growth, which you might remember is called the direction of integration. Every Enneagram type has a different type that they kind of almost like they integrate the healthy aspects of that type when they're healthy and they're moving in a positive direction. And then we also have a type that we kind of call the direction of disintegration, where we kind of devolve into under times of stress. So basically, soul child theory is saying that when we were children, we were actually a much purer version of our growth type, our integration type.
And that makes sense because we're the most pure version of ourselves. If you have ever spent any time around kids, they are just unapologetically themselves.
Yeah.
And then as they grow into adults or even teenagers, they learn different behaviors to kind of tamp themselves down.
Yeah. So somewhere along the way in childhood, we received the message that we couldn't or shouldn't be that way, the type of our soul, like our soul child's type. And then we develop our dominant type, the type you would identify as today as an adult, as a response to not being allowed to be, quote unquote, or being shamed out of, or feeling unsafe being the type your soul actually kind of wants to be. I find this fascinating.
This makes so much sense, too,
yeah.
Because it means that your dominant intent, so the result that you get when you go take the Enneagram, is really, that's your comfort zone. Those are your learned behaviors based on who you thought you should be, which is why it just hits so hard. You're like, oh yeah, that is what I have started doing. That is it. Like, that's how I protected myself. This is my security blanket that I've taken on because I didn't think I was allowed to be who I really am.
Yeah. So we're not going to obviously get into the nitty gritty of the Enneagram. You have 2 hours worth of content that you could go listen to. And now you can go listen to Sarah Jane, her content too, since we're like her biggest fans and she's never met us right now. But I think that you don't need to know all of this in order to find what we're about to say relevant. But I just want to highlight the fact that the Enneagram is not like other assessments in that when you get your type, you know, on like the Myers-Briggs or something, it doesn't really have positive or negative connotations. There's no real baggage with it. It just is what it is. It's how you're wired. The Enneagram is a little bit different. Your personality type, your number on the Enneagram is often kind of like the stuff you struggle with the most. It's where your ego tends to get caught up the most. It's the place where you tend to kind of repeat the same patterns over and over again, sometimes to your detriment. It's often a lot of your hangups and your biggest kind of beef with life is caught up in your Enneagram type, in your dominant type, which is why I feel like it makes sense that we may have, according to soul child theory, originally been at our purest sense of self, like a different type, and that we then had to sort of adapt an outer layer, almost like an armor, in order to survive or make it in the world.
Yeah. That's why we say, for us personally and for a lot of our clients, the reaction you get when you get your Enneagram type is not like, oh yeah, that sounds like me. It's like, oh my God, I just got seen and exposed for some of like the parts that I don't really like to show. It just feels very vulnerable and like, woo, yep, that is me. Not the prettiest parts of me.
An uncomfortable but accurate call out is what the Enneagram should feel like when it's
you hit
right
on your type.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right. So The whole point of this theory is that when you start consciously moving in the direction of integration, aka the direction of your soul child, you know, your soul child's type, you do that when you're willing to drop that security blanket. So you, when you're willing to drop the habits and the fears and the patterns and the behaviors of your dominant type that you keep repeating out of kind of a need for security or out of fear.
Yeah, because each type has, like we said, really great qualities and some really challenging qualities. And so this direction of integration and this soul child type, that's like the purest, most positive version of each type. Like that's what you're striving for in each type. And you probably ended up somewhere a little further down in your dominant type, which is why it feels like I'm not super proud of some of the things that I'm uncovering here.
Okay, so we're going to now get into each type and their soul child type. So we're just going to start at number one.
So for type one, beneath every self-controlled, self-contained one is a little seven who just wants to explore and play and go after everything they want. But somewhere along the way, they receive the message that there's a proper way to do things. And so they learn to restrain themselves.
So what that means is that self-referencing, playful, charming, open, spontaneous little sevens adapt to become proper, contained, self-controlled, restrained, disciplined ones. I have seen this play out with type ones or with, I definitely have a couple of type ones I'm thinking of in my life where at their core, I think that they do gravitate toward things that are kind of fun and playful and spontaneous, but then they kind of hold themselves back because maybe someone shamed them for being all over the place or scattered when they were really little. And now they're just like almost afraid to have too much fun, or they're afraid to venture outside of the comfort zone of their norm.
You can see this happening too. The kids who are just spontaneous and fun and just really out there and super playful, then they go to some point like school where, no, you have to sit in your seat and you have a proper way of doing things and there's rules in there. And so they learn that's how I be a good girl or a good boy. Mm-hmm. And so they can take on those qualities of a one because it feels like it's too big to be their natural seven selves.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so type two. Beneath every kind, generous, and other-directed two is a little four who tries every way possible to express his or her needs and desires, but never quite felt like they were enough. So they learned to feel like they were enough through serving and loving others. If they served and loved, then they'd receive love.
Mm. So the self-referencing, expressive, creative, emotionally honest, concerned with their own worth, little fours, adapt to become helpful and kind and generous and loving and blind to their own needs as little as twos.
So a lot of people are going to hear that and they're going to think, what's wrong with being helpful, kind, generous, and loving?
To their detriment.
Right.
To the point that they're not taking care of themselves anymore. That was that last, blind to their own needs, twos. That's the downfall of twos.
Mm-hmm.
And I see this a lot. I know a lot of twos, just personally, but also clients, who they felt like it's not okay to be concerned with my own needs. It's not okay to be, like they felt selfish or self-absorbed.
Or they were actively told it was selfish to have your own needs or to express your own opinions or desires. And so if that's not safe, then I'm going to have to like
do the opposite.
Basically do the opposite. You can kind of see that the theory makes sense considering how much you can kind of see that it's in reaction to something from earlier in your childhood.
I also see type twos very often getting very resentful for how much they're giving. And they want acknowledgement for that, and they want to be seen for that. And so you can see a bit of the four coming out, being like, hey, wait, what about me?
Right, what about me?
Because they don't give themselves permission to make it about them. So sometimes they'll get really resentful and annoyed by everyone else who they're putting first, but that's because they're putting them first.
So again, the goal is to grow. And so as a two, growth means getting back to the sort of four who lives at your core, which is someone who is concerned with your own worth and who's honest with other people in terms of what you're willing and not willing to give, and who can be expressive and isn't shutting down your own needs so that you can serve other people all the time.
Yep.
And I love that. Like, to me, that's just, I don't know how you could argue with that, which is why I feel like this theory holds, holds water. Yeah.
So type three, beneath every confident, self-assured, and forward-moving three is the little six who worried about the world not being enough for them and things not working out. They learned along the way that they could find certainty through achievement. And so if they could just be their best, then their anxieties would go away.
If they could be the best, not even their best, the best.
Yeah. Because the best of all.
Threes are very, very, well, threes are the achiever. And that's, you know, the way that they get worth is through proving their accomplishments in the world to other people. So worried, skeptical, uncertain, loyal, committed little sixes adapt to become confident, self-assured, driven, ambitious, afraid of failure, threes. So again, people are going to look at this and they're going to go, wait, so you're telling me that my soul child is a worried, skeptical, uncertain person and that that's who I should go back to being? They're going to not like that.
Well, but there's also things like loyal and committed. Like, again, there's pros and cons to each of these.
Right. So
types.
Even your soul child type, I know we kind of, I don't know if we actually said the opposite of this earlier. If so, I didn't mean to, or Kristen didn't mean to imply that it's only positive. But again, there's positive and negative things associated with, or, you know, good qualities and difficult qualities, I think, associated with each type. And so even in your soul child type, yeah, I think that there's going to be things like maybe you tended toward being a worrier when you were a kid, or maybe you were a little bit skeptical as a kid. But to a degree, those things are not necessarily problematic because, like, the healthy sixes I've met are not so torn up with worry that they can't relax. And they might actually use their propensity for being skeptical or for, you know, kind of thinking through all the details of things, the way that you can kind of get fixated on when you're worrying, you can turn that into an advantage of being someone who's just good at thinking ahead or good at planning.
Right. So like being cautious can cause anxiety, or being cautious can mean you're a very conscientious person who makes really thorough, well thought out decisions.
Right.
And so yeah, all of these can be taken. Obviously, the direction of integration that we're all trying to get to, we're trying to get to the best qualities of our original soul child type. But yeah, there's going to be parts of that soul child that are going to be hard for you too. And this is a good example of that.
Well, hard, but almost good to integrate, which I feel like I'll be able to talk more about in type four because this is my situation. So type four, beneath every unconventional, unrestrained, and original four is a little type one who just wanted to be good, that desires to control themselves and the world around them and seeks to be assured that they are doing the right thing. Yet somewhere along the way, they learned that no matter how hard they tried, they'd never be good enough. And if they couldn't be good, they would at least be special and prove to the world through that method that they were meant to be this way.
So these contained, proper, self-constrained, disciplined, controlled little ones adapt to become unconventional and unrestrained and expressive and emotionally honest and self-doubting fours.
Yeah. So when I first read this, I was like, okay, I'm not crying. Like, you know, Stacy's over there crying and Joanna's crying. And I'm like, right. So you're telling me that my inner child is just like a proper, disciplined, controlling, self-constrained person. And that's who I'm supposed to aspire to be. Like, I didn't sit well with me for a bit. And then I gave it a few days. And then I was like, oh. The more I think about that, the more accurate that feels, because I remember basically up until puberty, up until like 10, I was like nothing like you would. I was not like the way that you see me now. I was shy.
I wish I could have known you back then.
I was shy. I was, you know, I was quiet. I was often worried about what other people thought. I definitely was disciplined and self, like, no one ever had to tell me how to do my homework. Well, no one ever did. Like, that part didn't go away. But I was kind of, like, boring. And not in a bad way. It's just, like,
you were
I was
content
just
with
kind
just
of being myself, you know? And I remember, this is, like, kind of a turning, maybe not the turning point, but it kind of shows, like, where, and I think puberty is probably often a place where we start to if not earlier, but puberty probably definitely does it, where we start to develop our dominant type in reaction to what we're, you know, people shaming us for the type we might kind of be at our core. I remember one time in middle school, we were like the eighth grade class. We hadn't had an eighth grade when I was in seventh grade. Like when I was in sixth grade and seventh grade, we didn't have like all three grades because it was a new school. So basically in seventh grade, we were the upperclassmen. And then in eighth grade, we were the upperclassmen in middle school. And they did this yearbook interview where they interviewed a couple people about what it was like to be the old kids the whole time, which is such a dumb thing, but they did. And I got quoted and I was like so proud of my answer, which was like, it's like so good to be like a role model and to like, you know, I just like a very earnest, like pure, very proper answer. It's exactly what it was. It was a proper little answer.
One that you would now roll your eyes at, I'm sure.
Okay. But then this kid on the bus asked me what I said and he was like, I mean, that's cool and all, but do you have to have such a stick up your ass?
Aww.
And I was like, oh, it's not okay to be like that. That's boring. Kids don't like that. Kids like you when you're interesting or a little bit rebellious or cooler. And so it's like, oh, maybe this loud and out personality is actually just in some ways a defense for
the boring,
proper kid who lives in my heart and who really just wants everyone to load the dishwasher the right way. And who thinks that there's a right and a wrong way to do things and is kind of a perfectionist and is honestly a bit of a wet blanket. And I was like, well, damn, this is true.
You're making ones not sound super appealing.
But that's the thing is that I feel like if you're just allowed to be your type, I think that sometimes ones would just be like, yeah, there's a right way to do things. And this is just how I want to be. Like,
yeah. Yeah, it will just feel right.
Right. Like, why can't I just be a bit of a stick in the mud? Why? You know, like that wasn't enough. And that's exactly what it said earlier, was that that was not enough to entertain people or to keep them interested in me. So, okay, be interesting.
You took that very seriously.
Yeah, clearly. Still suffering for it.
Okay.
All right.
So type five. Beneath every self-contained, unassuming, and non-assertive five is a vivacious little eight, an unstoppable, highly territorial, and aggressive eight who isn't afraid to go after exactly what they want. But somewhere along the way, they learned that it wasn't appropriate to make a fuss or demand what they want, so they learned to internalize and hoard instead of demanding and taking.
Some of you type fives are going to be like, no, I'm not a hoarder. Yeah, you are. You're a hoarder of information.
Yeah.
That's what fives do.
Intellectual
hoarding.
They hoard hoarding.
Data and, you know, they analyze everything and they're very prone to like overthinking. So it might not be physical stuff you're hoarding. It's often information that you're hoarding. So bold, vivacious, aggressive, territorial, action-oriented little eights adapt to become non-assertive, unassuming, action-repressed, self-contained, internalizing fives.
You can see how this happens.
Yeah.
If you are aggressive and you're kind of like bold and this is what I want, you go after it and you're told, stop being so much or stop being so, or like be share and be nicer. You're just going to retreat into yourself and be like, okay, I'm just going to be unassuming. I'm not going to try to be too assertive because I don't want to get any blowback. And I'm just going to go in my head.
Well, and I think it's almost like the type eight on the inside is this wild kind of like feral, but in a good way, little kid who's just like doing what they want and isn't overthinking or thinking about anything. They're just doing. And then someone causes you to start doubting yourself or you start overthinking. And then all of a sudden you can't take action anymore. You're not confident in your abilities anymore. And so you have to overthink everything now. It makes perfect sense how that could happen and why those are kind of the opposite of each other.
Yeah.
Okay, type six. Beneath every hyped up, vigilant and insightful six is a little nine who is relaxed, easygoing, and not overly concerned about potential threats. Somewhere along the way, the six learned that it wasn't safe to be so relaxed, and they started to keep their eyes out for potential threats and pitfalls as a way to maintain their safety.
So relaxed, accepting, easygoing, comfortable in their own little world, nines adapt to become vigilant, skeptical, loyal, security-focused, and safety-oriented sixes. Again, you can see it's like jumping from one extreme to another.
You used to be, like, at your core, before the world told you to distrust things, you used to trust that things would work out. and you sort of learned along the way things were not going to work out, or someone told you they weren't going to work out. And so you now lost your sense of support or that belief you had in things being easy and flowing. And now it's your job to you know, make sure they work out, which gives you a lot of anxiety and worry and, you know, kind of makes you almost look to other people for support instead of trusting yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, it's a scary world out there. And you're like, if I don't take reins myself, what, you know, if I just stay relaxed and chill and kind of like letting things flow, then everything's going to come crumbling down. And
your child
so you
self
kind of start to become a worrier.
And your child self knew that wasn't true. And that's the goal, is to get back to the person who knew that without having to be told.
Exactly. So type seven. Beneath every charming, engaged, and engaging, freedom-seeking seven is a little five who craves time to themselves, time with their thoughts, and wants space to think and explore internally and not share their resources. But somewhere along the way, they learned that they needed to keep the joy up in order for things to be okay. So they learned that if they keep their minds happy and ignore their pain, they can ensure that their needs get met. Through happiness, they can keep people from prying.
So autonomous, internal, self-contained, unassuming, holds on to their resources, little fives, adapt to become charming, freedom-seeking, joyful, pain-ignoring, limitation-fearing sevens.
Mm-hmm.
This is an interesting, like, spectrum, but I totally understand it. Like, it's like I kind of just wanted to be left to my own devices and explore my inner space and just, you know, feel free to be quiet. And then it's almost like, no, I have to be the entertainer or something. I'm not allowed to be with myself in that way. I have to kind of maybe distract other people from their pain or convince people, no, you don't have to feel that way. I can see a lot of...
And distract themselves from their own internal dialogue, because that's what they actually really wanted. They want to dive deep and they're going to find some tough stuff down there. But then once they turn into seven, they're like, oh, never mind. Don't look over here. Just fun, charming, you know, let's just go have an adventure.
Distract ourselves from our pain or someone else's
from
pain.
Our internal worlds.
Okay, type eight. Beneath every big, bold, and powerful eight is a little two whose heart is open and gooey and soft. Someone who cares too much about what others think and lacks an intrinsic sense of self-worth. Somewhere along the way, the eight learned that being this soft and open meant getting destroyed. So they built up a defense and became powerful as a way to make sure they were never controlled.
This one breaks my heart because... So vulnerable, loving, warm, relationship-oriented, approval-seeking little twos adapt to become vivacious, aggressive, bold, territorial, action-oriented eights. And the reason that this one, like, just really, like, oh, gets me is because you can imagine these little twos who are just so open and so loving and so vulnerable. And in order to make this big transition into that eight type, something bad probably happened. You know,
they got taken
advantage of, or they got their feelings stomped all over.
They had to be hurt in a pretty big way.
They had to be hurt emotionally, maybe physically, in order for them to put these big walls up and become kind of aggressive and powerful as a way of making sure they don't get hurt again.
And, you know, eights, when they're not at their healthiest, are the type who are like, I'm going to hurt you before you can hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes sense if at your core, you're actually just like a really hurt little two who was very loving and who was not, whose love was not treated kindly and was not reciprocated or was not treated with any sort of tenderness.
Yeah, the saying is true that hurt people hurt people.
Yeah.
And that's what can happen when you're such an open and loving two who might get hurt in some way. And you don't know what to do with that when you get older. Okay, so type nine. This is my type. Save the best for last.
Okay, agree to disagree. Continue.
Beneath every humble, unassertive, and collaborative nine is a little three who's ambitious, competitive, confident, and who seeks to lead and gain recognition for their accomplishments. Somewhere along the way, the nine learned that they were better seen and not heard, that their needs caused too much stress to those closest to them. So they started to soften their preferences and quiet their input as a way to ensure they didn't lose the connections that meant the most to them.
So ambitious, competitive, confident, action-oriented, unafraid to be seen little threes become relaxed, accepting, comfortable, inner world-dwelling, tempted to numb out nines.
this like gets me in my gut because when I think of myself, especially when I was young in school, I was that, I was a little Hermione. I mean, just raising my hand and wanting to have the right answer and feeling like, yeah, I like knew better than everyone. Like I felt that way. And like, I wanted to get the best grade on all of my homework. Like and that doesn't feel relevant hardly at all to me anymore.
I mean, you were still kind of like that in college, but it came off as more passive aggressive at that point.
I'm talking like the act. I don't think I was super, well, maybe I was ambitious. I don't know. But it felt different when I was a kid. It just felt like I wanted to do really well. Like I loved learning and I loved kind of like showing off what I knew.
Were you confident and assertive in any other arena?
Yeah. In friendships, I would speak up a lot more when I was younger. And then I despised like drama in arguments between friends. So pretty early on, I can remember my earliest friend group when I was maybe in like elementary or middle school. Where there were some bold personalities and I would be like, I want to do this or I want to color with it. Because I was an only child, so I was used to just, I'd do what I want. And we would get in little fights and I was like, this feels so terrible and I'm so afraid of them not being my friend anymore that I'm just going to not speak up and go along with the flow and share whatever you want to do as a way to keep the peace.
Yeah, I think it seems like a lot of nines at some point learned that there can't be like two achievers in the room at the same time. And so I'm going to have to just back off so I can keep these people around me.
If you want friends, you can't be in battle.
You can't
all
be
the
best.
You can't be the best.
No one wants to be friends with the best because it's annoying.
Uh-huh. Yeah, exactly. Yep. Yeah. So that's heartbreaking in its own way.
And again, that means that in order to grow, if you're a nine, you have to move back into the direction of a healthy three. You have to become someone who's willing to assert yourself and speak up and be confident and own your achievements, which is what a lot of nines I know could use more of.
And what they're afraid of.
Right. Well, because they've got unconscious damage around this issue.
Yep.
Because someone told them or someone proved to them it's not safe or you're not going to be accepted. In any of these instances, you're not going to be safe or accepted if you kind of revert back to who you really were at your core.
Yeah.
So what's funny is that when you call yourself a one, it's like a four is actually more of a real one at their core than you are.
Yeah, it's true.
Because, you know, the personality type you have adapted is really, again, kind of a construct, a security blanket to keep you safe and to give you a personality that you feel like in some way can be your identity and can maybe protect you from harm or insulate you from disapproval. It's an adaptive thing for our survival.
Yeah, it's like you're put on the suit of a different type to kind of camouflage who you really are because you fear who you really are is not accepted. So I'm going to take on this other type because I think that that's going to get me further and that's going to get me better results in life.
So I guess so I should just aspire to be a little bit more boring.
I should aspire to be a little bit more ambitious, I guess.
Sure. I'd benefit a lot from you being more ambitious. So that would be fine with me. And I'm not saying come out here quoting me like ones are boring. First of all, if at my core I'm a real one, then I'm allowed to say that. And second of all, sometimes I feel like, aren't you exhausted by the trappings of your dominant type? Because sometimes I am. Yeah. Sometimes I'm like, I don't need to be entertaining today. Or I don't need to be interesting. Or why am I trying? You know, I don't feel like I'm trying so hard. But God, maybe I am really trying that hard. You know, I think that a lot of my clients, what we end up coaching around when it comes to the Enneagram is how not to give in to your type.
Yeah.
How not to lean into what your type wants you to do. Because often what your type wants you to do is the exact opposite of what's good for you.
Yeah, they become your default reactions. And usually it's people's default reactions that are not serving them.
Right. And so in case of me being a 4-1, like my default reaction is just to laze around and do nothing and complain about the world. But a 1, a really healthy 1, gets their shit together and they're disciplined and they do stuff even when they don't feel like doing it sometimes because it's the right thing to do and it's the proper thing to do, which is not necessarily bad if your inclination is to just, you know, lounge around like Cleopatra eating grapes, wondering how your rent's going to get paid, you know?
Right.
You could use a little more of that if that's what your MO is.
Yeah, discipline's not a bad quality at all.
Right. And the same goes for all of these. So I'm sorry we spent more time on the things that we can relate to, but I hope you just will understand and forgive us for that. But if you relate to these, that's what your job is. You can tell us how this landed with you.
Yeah, tell us share your feedback. Your actual type is and what your soul child type is and how you relate to it.
Oh, okay. I want to remind them, too, that they can take the Enneagram if they haven't done so yet.
Yes.
So there are links in the episode description of a free version and a paid version. Kristen and I have taken both. I prefer the paid version.
Mine
it's only $12.
Accurate. Mine actually, my free version.
Mistyped you.
It was a version of it, but it flipped my primary and secondary, and the paid version got it accurate.
Yeah.
So I just think it's, you know, you get what you pay for. It's, what, $9, I think?
$12.
It's cheap.
Yeah. But I mean, take either. Take both. Whatever. But if you want to take it and you haven't, then go back and do that. And of course, you can go back to our other episodes that we did about the actual book, The Wisdom of the Enneagram. I linked to those too. Those are from August of 2019. Yeah,
you can geek out about the Enneagram with us because we do some deep dives.
On that series. Yeah. Okay.
And
so
just to remind you from the beginning, if you want to get texts from us,
yep,
make sure you sign up because we'll only text you if you say we can text you and you give us your phone number.
I mean, I can't literally cannot text you if I don't have your phone number. So 703-783-3223, pull up your name, space, email address, send it. You can also, instead of texting us that way, you can also just sign up on our site. So there's a link in the episode description. You can just click that, enter your name and email and phone number. And if you don't even want to be that lazy to go to the episode description, you can just literally type in clarityonfire.com/text-me and it'll take you there.
And we will be texting you on Monday with your very first ever Clarity on Fire text.
Depending on where in the world you are, maybe you'll wake up to a text from us.
I don't know if we can text internationally. I'll have to check on that.
Oh, no.
You can try.
Why not?
Yeah, try.
But I hope that doesn't, they don't get charged for that.
No, they wouldn't.
You don't think?
I don't know.
Let's hope not. Let's figure that out for them. We'll be back on Monday or Tuesday we won't be back on Tuesday.
No, we won't.
Because remember, we're going to every other week on Tuesdays. If you need a reminder about that, go back to this Tuesday's episode and you can hear our announcement about that. So I'm sorry, but we are actually not going to be back on Tuesday.
We'll be back next Friday.
Okay. All right. See you then.
Bye.